Well, if you would open your Bibles to Colossians, the third chapter, verses 16 and 17 is what we're going to focus on. I'm back in Colossians. I was away from it for Palm Sunday and the Easter Sunday. Today, we're back in Colossians. And I don't know that I'm going to stay there. I actually have just been in Colossians 3. The thing I love about preaching through the Bible is it keeps me from getting on soapboxes and saying, oh, I saw them. No. Ken needs to hear this. I need to preach this for Ken. No. I don't need to do that. Jennifer needs to hear something. I'll let her, do that. Or Sam needs to hear. No, I just preach the word. And we come into something and it hits your life. You're like, oh, well, we just preached through that. Brother Mike wasn't targeting me. Because, hey, sometimes pastors do that. They know about a problem. I've served in a church that the pastor would preach through entire books of the Bible. Like, I think he was in 1 Corinthians for 6 to 9 months or whatever. And the beautiful thing about it is, as a staff member, I would know of things going on in the church, that needed to be addressed. And it was amazing how the Word of God would address them. We didn't have to go seeking out of, well, I need to straighten this person out. If you look to the Word of God, it'll straighten you out, okay? If you read it yourself and just hear it explained, I don't have to fuss at anybody about it. I just exhort what the Scripture says. And many times it fixed many of the problems. Now, we still sometimes have to go to people and talk to them, and that's understandable. But let's just read these passages of Scripture. I've gone back to the English Standard Version of Scripture because I feel like with all the different translations you have in your Bibles, it sort of fits right in the middle. And whether you got a King James or a New King James or an NIV or whatever, it seems to just sort of fit better. I was preaching out of the Christian Standard Bible that I like a lot. But I've gone back to this one, and of course I'm going to be honest with you, using the Reformation Study Bible, and study notes are excellent in this Bible, and I said, this is why it was my pulpit Bible for years, because there's just some deep, rich theology that they point out too, so that's another reason. But let's look at Colossians, the third chapter, verses 16 and 17. Read, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Jim, I'm going to ask you on the sound to turn my monitor way down. I think that may be the issue. They may need to hear me out there, but turn my monitor down. There you go. That's better. See, now it's not ringing. That's right. I want them to hear me, but yeah, that's better. Because again, I don't want to spend 30 minutes this afternoon trying to adjust equalization. That's supposed to be a quick thing for me to post this. But we're going to talk about biblical worship. And a lot of people have made worship as, well, I just sort of feel this way and I just do it. But God has always had a prescribed way that we're supposed to worship. In other words, I'm an old country boy, but we don't just haul off and worship God. We don't have kings and queens here, but with the death of Prince Philip, in England, I think we're sometimes even enamored a little bit with the class and the dignity, all that comes with the office of a king and a queen. We're sort of rebellious Americans that, we broke off from the king and queen, and I appreciate the freedom we have in this country to say that, I don't like President so-and-so or Representative so-and-so, and I can freely criticize them, at least right now I can, without going to jail or whatever, okay? I hope we can continue to do that. And by the way, pray for your leaders, whether they're local, national, whatever, you need to do that as well, but pray for them. And I will say leadership's hard. I mean, if we had the most godly leader, leadership's not easy. Okay, it's real easy to take. I used to be one of those people sort of griped about leaders that I became one, and I'm like, it's not harder. It's not harder. Whether you're running a business or whether you're running an organization or you're a supervisor, it's just, it's always easy to have an idea of what ought to be done, but trying to implement it's a little harder. So do pray for them. But at the same time, let me tell you, when it comes to worship, God is the ultimate one that deserves our worship. And biblical worship is a response that God's creation owes to him as he reveals himself to him. So as we worship him, we honor and glorify him by just gratefully offering back to him all the good gifts that he's given us, as well as we acknowledge his greatness and his goodness. We praise him for who he is, and we thank him for what he has done. And we desire for him to increase in glory through continuing acts of mercy judgment and power. That's what we want to see. You know, we pray for the well-being of others. We pray for our own well-being. You should do that. Okay? You should ask God to bless us. In the Lord's Prayer, it says, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, here on earth as it is in heaven. What's the next phrase? Give us our what? Daily bread. It's okay to ask for it. Lord, I need something to eat. I need clothes to put on. I need you to prosper me in my business. Okay? Yeah, I need that. And I do, you know, and I'm thankful for the people who have encouraged me. The group I've been able to plug into that encourages me in the insurance business to plug ahead, to go for it, to not let fear hold us back. And so we need that. And so, but I want to say too that learning from God is also worship. As you come here today to learn. See, worship is not just I sing this praise and worship song and I engage in worship and how great it is. Because, you know, 45 minutes of singing worship songs can't erase if I've been living in sin and wickedness and rebelling against the Lord. He's not really pleased with that. If I'm simply singing, whether it be hymns or worship songs, but I never read the Bible, I never come to any Bible study time, I never come to learn, I mean, that's worship too. You got to, you know, if you... You know, I don't know about you, but people like musical figures. I'm a person as a music historian and likes to read about different groups. I like to read about them. I have a lot of books about musicians, biographies and other things. I can tell you, you know, my kids can tell you that, man, I have multiple books and I have multiple CDs and I even have some records and some tapes of the late Johnny Cash. I tell you about anything you want about what you want to know about Johnny Cash. Talk to me after the worship service. I tell you. Because I really like Johnny Cash. I always did, you know, and that's right. You know, I've got, you know, when Cecily was real little, he had become real popular again in the mid-1990s. And I bought a lot of his tapes and CDs. My youngest daughter, I was riding with her in the car. And of course, you know, kids, they don't play CDs much anymore. Tapes, they play, you know, they just stream something on the phone. And in her playlist, Johnny Cash song came up. I'm like, I'm impressed. I raised her right, you know. But if you love somebody, you want to learn about them. And that same way with Johnny Cash, or whatever the musician is, you want to learn about them. And, you know, we honor him when we pay attention to the word of instruction, and failing to pay attention to his instructions is an offense to him. It is. It's a sin. Acceptable worship, as it says in Psalm 24:4, requires us to have clean hands and a pure heart. So we've got to possess a willingness to express devotion in works of service as well as in words of praise and adoration. In other words, I love Jesus, but you know, we need things done in the church, but nobody does them. Well, that's a problem too. You're not volunteers. We're servants of the Lord. And I certainly have told you before, I don't believe in working you to death to keep the program going. And I hate to say many churches, it's that way. You're just a cog in the wheel to keep the program going. That's all they care about. They don't care about anything. They really don't care about you. They'll tell you that. And I want y'all to know, you say, that's not controversial, Brother Mike. I get to pastor's meetings, and I was saying this before I was a pastor. I say those kind of things in the meetings, and I'm not the most popular pastor guy there, okay? Because some guys immediately connect with me, amen, brother, but it's like, because some of them don't mind using people. I hate to say that. Sometimes people get to promoting their own program. We're not to do that, but you know, if we have to beg you to do things, like the reason this gospel singing goes well is because you guys serve. I mean, a lot of you are, you do get to sit back and listen to the music, but some are getting up and getting the food ready while that's going on. They're not in here while we're singing. They're having to be out there and do things. There's people now that leave the worship service to go count money real quickly, to do other things. What if they said, well, I just can't do that. I want to be here for the whole thing.
That's right.
That would be a problem. You know, I mean, we have to have stuff done. Sometimes you have to give up something. You know, eventually, I miss Miss JoJo today. I'm not having to preach over her, but I was happy for her to be here. And she was loud last week, but that's okay. I got loud too, okay? So, you know, I know she didn't drown me out when I listened to the sermon that I recorded. I got loud too, you know? And at some point, there may need to be a regular nursery ministry for that. We need to get people going. But, you know, right now, we don't have as many, but that may be a need. And we'll work that out when the time comes. We need you to serve. So But serving is part of that. It's part of worship. And in the Old Testament, and my daughter laughed at me and said, "Dad, you got a long intro." And I do. I promise you the intro is longer than the sermon. But in the Old Testament, the foundation for worship was a covenant relationship he had with his people. And so, you know, it's the same way today. In the Old Testament, there were the Jewish people had these rules and rituals they had to follow to properly worship God. And some of these rules and rituals were to show the people how sinful they were and how they could never become holy enough on their own with their own efforts. In a sense, God was setting them up to fail to show them how much he needed them, okay? And you may have even done that with an employee at work. You weren't trying to put them down, but they sort of thought they were hot stuff, and you gave them a tough task you knew they could do, let them fail, so now you can teach them, okay? Now they're humble, and they're willing to learn from you. I know I would appreciate the older men when I worked construction work, and how they were not mean to me, but they let me go out there and fail a little bit so that now I was ready to listen to them. Yeah, I'm there to hear their wisdom. Well, God does that because he wanted the people to ultimately receive Jesus and receive the true meaning of the law. And so you have people that are, and by the way, some of you, probably in this room, there's different personalities here. Some of you are, I mean, I believe in rules, but I'm not as hard. I'm more about the spirit of the rule than the letter of the law. But I served in a church with a wonderful godly lady. I mean, I believe she really loved Jesus, but she's about the rules. You know, we got to keep the rules, you know. I'm sort of, you know, I mean, let's face it. It's a wonder I don't have more speeding tickets than I do, because I sort of like, that's a suggestion, you know. You know, we were running late for a game, you know. I mean, I want to tell you that, you know, I mean, I see that 90 out there. I'm like, I can go 90. I want to hold it 65. That's right. So, you know, there's no major roads between here and right, you know. Now, I don't blow people off the road or act rude. I promise you that. And I get in the right lane no matter how fast I'm going. I pull over and get back on the right side.
Right.
But, you know, no, there's a place, there's rules are there, but I also know those rules are there for safety. So I do remember that there, it's not there to, you know, yeah, I would do well in Germany on the Autobahn, you know, left lane, fast you drive. You know, that's just me. That's right. That's a bad example to my son. You know, that's what Benton even said. He was going to fire me as instructor and let his mother be his driving instructor because he knows I'm not setting the proper example for him. So I'm not setting the proper example for these young people. I know. So, you know, yes. Yeah, so just probably don't want to put me on the church van, you know, if you on the insurance there, you know. So I've never wrecked one. Actually, I did. The one accident I had was actually in a gas station parking lot. It wasn't actually on the road. I actually, if your kids are in the car with me, I promise I'm going to drive a lot safer. Okay, that's right. So, but anyway, these rules are there, and rules are important, you know, but at the same time, a lot of this Old Testament stuff was a pattern. And so the Passover pointed to the Lord's Supper, to Jesus' death on our behalf. The Day of Atonement was pointing to Jesus' death on the cross and our need for cleansing. The daily sacrifice is pointing to the need for Jesus' once-for-all sacrifice, so we didn't have to do that every day. Wouldn't it be something if every time you messed up, you had to come to me and I had to offer this, you know, this bull or this calf or this goat? I mean, these priests had to get tired of that. I wish these people quit sinning. You know, this is getting old, you know? But we do want to know some of these things that pointed to Christ, what we call typical, or they were types. They were types of Christ. They revealed what Christ was going to do. Some of them, like worshiping out of the book of Psalms, and some of the things we do, assembling and meeting together, those are still important. Meeting for prayer, meeting for singing, that was done in the Old Testament. We do that today. We should still keep doing that. But others cease to be needed, and this is where some of the legalistic groups have problems. Seventh-day Adventists, you'll have two different camps amongst Seventh-day Adventists. Some real law-driven, and there's very little grace in what they do. Then I know others that are very excited about Jesus and what he did on the cross. I disagree with some of their teachings, but they're grounded in Jesus. But others are way out there. Really, I can tell they don't know anything of the grace and mercy of Jesus because they're just so into the Old Testament law and they're hung up on that. But the key is always pointing to Christ. So the good news is today we live in a glorious day where we don't have to daily offer these sacrifices when we sin and fail. You know, John 1:7 tells us what? If we walk in the light, as he, Jesus, is in the light, the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. And that cleansing, if you look at the scripture, getting to the Greek New Testament, it means it's a continual cleansing. We're continually, right now, you're being continually cleansed from sin. It's happening right now. The Heavenly Father sees you as perfect if you're in Christ because of Jesus. And so that helps you to worship. And so, you know, we don't have to do all these rituals. And one of the big changes that was made, and I think I talked about this the last few weeks, was the Sabbath worship. In the Old Testament, until Jesus' resurrection, worshipers worship on the seventh day. Because that was the day that God rested from creation, right? So, but what happened on Sunday? What big momentous thing happened? Last week. He rose from the dead on Sunday. So, yeah, we observe the resurrection of Jesus. But you know what? The fact that we're here today says we're observing the resurrection of Jesus. That's right. We're observing the resurrection today. And every Sunday that we show up. Because it's a big deal. And so it changed the whole thing. So now we don't have all these legalistic rules that we had. The Apostle Paul, you know, basically chewed Peter out in front of a bunch of folks. Because Peter got to wanting to make the Gentile people go back and do all the Old Testament regulations about food and stuff. And God had used Peter to sort of dispel some of that. But, you know, you get to hanging around legalists for a while if you're not careful. The Pharisees and religious people, we as Christians have got to be careful about this. Yes, there are rules and regulations for holiness, but we had better be people immersed in grace. And we're going to see that today about letting the Word of Christ live in us. So, you know, every day is to be lived in worship, not just on the Day of Atonement or on a Passover, not just on Sunday or Easter Sunday or Christmas. You know, I mean, I enjoy those seasons because sometimes you do get people to come out and come. I wish we had some visitors that had showed up last Sunday, but a lot of them were they were open. I mean, nobody was offended that I asked them. I didn't harass anybody, but I probably came close to, hey, you know, I kept sending texts, hey, I want you to come. And they were okay with that because people tend to come to church on Easter and Christmas. But every day is to be lived in worship, whether you're at church, at school, at work, at a ball game, whether you're in the community. You know, we live a life of worship. We're at the ball game that Bentley is at, and we're encouraging kids. Sometimes I get to speak the truth. You know, one kid quit the team in the middle of a game, you know, today, and I was trying to find him because I was going to pray with him, and one of the mothers had said, when you pray with him, you'll whoop his rear end too. But I'm like, I was going to pray for him, and I was going to try to talk to him, and I couldn't catch up with him. But I was going to minister to him because he needed some ministry. He was very frustrated. And we need to be ready to minister at all times. So I have just 2 points today. I told you it's a long intro. The Word of Christ, we want to look at that. It tells us, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly in verse 16. And so, here's what we want to know. That the gospel has come to us already, but merely coming to us is not enough. It's good that the gospel's come to us, and maybe you've repented of your sins. You've believed that Jesus is the Savior who died on the cross for you, who rose from the dead. And he's living forevermore, and you've confessed your sin, and you've received him as Savior. That's good.
Amen.
And that's enough to get you to heaven, and that's it. It's all about Christ. But just merely knowing that he's come to you is not enough. Here's what's got to happen. The gospel in our life must keep house. It must be at home in us. So I didn't have you writing at all, and I'm going to have you writing all the time, filling in the blanks here. It's got to be at home in us. It's got to be at home in our hearts. Right. Now, let me ask y'all, when it says heart, what do I mean? Do I mean this organ that pumps blood?
No.
What do I mean by soul? Or what's another word?
Mind.
Your mind? Even though I'm going to talk about the mind in a minute, there is an element of the mind in that. What's, anybody have a King James Bible with you? What does it say a lot of times? There's a phrase that it uses called bowels of compassion. Now, we don't use that term today. I know, you know, if somebody were to say, man, that person was so kind and wonderful to me. They just ministered to me with such great bowels of compassion. We're like, that sounds sort of gross, you know. Do they have Crohn's disease or something? I mean, what's up, you know? I have a little bit of a, you know, thankfully I don't have any symptoms, but I was diagnosed with ulcerated colitis a couple of years ago, and praise the Lord, I don't have any active symptoms with it, but yeah, it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean my intestines are acting funny, but think about it. You ever get butterflies in your stomach? You get afraid, or you get these tingling feelings? Okay.
Sure.
That's what it was talking about. So sometimes our emotions should be involved in worship, okay? Now, the problem is some people only have emotions, and they're being emotional, and they're waving their hands, and there's nothing wrong with worshiping that way. I grew up in classical Pentecostalism, and By the way, some of our worship services were just like the ones we have. But every so often, somebody gets to singing about Jesus, the Spirit would move, and people dance before the Lord. Some of them begin to shout, you know. My dad used to call out this song. It was a song called "It's Time to Get Ready, for the Lord is Coming Soon." And as soon as my dad would call out the number of that song in the songbook, I'm like, oh, no, not that song. Because Brother Jenkins is going to get up and shout. I know it. He's going to do it. And we'd get through the first verse in chorus, and he wouldn't do it. I'm like, I bet he's not going to do it today. But then about where Charles is sitting, this guy, he's on Walker, you know. And we finally get to, it was a two-verse song. We get to, it's time to get ready. He's on his way. And Brother Jenkins would get up himself and woo! You know, he gets so excited to think that Jesus was coming back. You know, and never fail. I don't think we ever went through that song. We sang that song. I just knew it. And I'm like, he's going to shout today. I just know it. And he would. You know, he would do it. And our emotions are okay. But as Damon mentioned, we also have to have our minds. If we just worship with our emotions and don't have our minds engaged, we could be led astray, couldn't we? We'd be led astray to all kinds of weird doctrines and things and think we're worshiping the Lord. We might say, if I were to ask y'all how many Jesuses are you, what would you say? How many are there?
One.
There's only one true one, but there's a lot of Jesuses in people's minds. A lot of people worship a Jesus. It's not exactly what this book portrays him as. We live in a world today that sort of picks and chooses what they want. We live in a world today where some people add a little bit of the Muslim religion, a little bit of Christianity, a little bit of Buddhism, a little bit of the New Age movement, and try to morph it into one and pick the God that they want. But it doesn't work that way. There is only one true Jesus, but our mind has got to be molded to the Word of God and worship Jesus properly. The Reformed Christians that are sort of certain types of Presbyterians, and there's even some Reformed Baptists. Some of them are overly strict. They'll sing nothing but hymns. Their worship services can be a little dour. And they're just so afraid that they're going to miss it and get away from the Word of God that their musical services can be a little boring sometimes, you know. And I appreciate what they're trying to do. I don't think it's one or the other. Some Pentecostal worship services are a fiasco. There's no truth in it. It's just a bunch of, especially the charismatic movement, a bunch of just praise, and they're all out there, but it's not based on truth. I've told you, there's two different worship services I've watched here lately that I appreciate what they're doing. Is these people, they get wound up. I mean, they go to dancing and shouting, but it's always about the truth about Jesus. The music is great, and it's energetic the whole time, but they don't really get wound up to the, you can tell it's like, wow, Jesus really is great. I'm looking forward to seeing him face to face. That, you know, Jesus is truly the Lord and God, and it's like, wow, that gets me excited. Jesus died on the cross for me. Hallelujah. And they go to running and shouting. But truth has ignited that. Truth must ignite your worship, not your emotions. And here's what we have to understand, too, about the gospel. It has to be a master that has a right to prescribe and direct everything under its roof. If the gospel's at home with us, it has a right to tell us how to live, how to worship Jesus. So that's important. Also, it must dwell richly in all richness. Not only keep house, but keep a good house. Y'all thought about that? I mean, it's not enough just to have a house to live in, but we want it to be clean, don't we? We want it to be taken care of. We must dwell richly, and we must meditate upon it. We must work at it to know the Word of Jesus. It's got to be a mighty force in our lives and have a strong influence on us. That's very important. And it says, you know, let the word of Christ dwell richly. Some Bible scholars thought, well, maybe they should have translated that word of God or whatever. But no, this is something this may be the only place it's really used here. Word of Christ. The message of Christ must dwell richly, and all its richness must be at home with us. And then here's what else happens. We stay here in verse 16. It says it's teaching and admonishing us. And here's the thing about our music. By the use of singable melodies, we easily learn things. We don't have as many children here today, but I was going to ask them to do something. Those of you here learned the ABCs, how did you learn the ABCs?
Singing it.
Yeah, you know, A, B, C, D, E, yeah. You remember that, right?
Oh, no,
yeah, that's right. Yeah, there's even, yeah, there's even, yeah, but there's, Sam's even signing it there. That's a, well, what are some other things? Maybe there's some even, there was a truth that we learned. We talked about a character in Sunday school today. What character did we talk about in Sunday school?
Zacchaeus.
Y'all remember? Zacchaeus was a wee little man. I learned that from Zacchaeus. That's right. I did. That's right. I learned about Zacchaeus from that. I mean, even if they're not great hymns, there was just these little simple children's songs taught us stuff. You learned about the love of Jesus, singing, Jesus love me, this I know. Okay, you do that. I mean, there's even songs, we learn about the victory we have in Christ. We really, if you think about it, how many know, I heard an old, old story, our Savior came. That only tells about the victory I have in Jesus. It tells me why I have the victory in Jesus. First verse, heard about a Savior, came from glory, the gospel message. It tells about his healing power. It tells about the future hope. Basically, it's doing what we talked about last week. Past, present, future salvation. That's a doctrinal song, even though it's more of a gospel type of song. And there's nothing wrong with that. So, singable, but it's an easy to sing song, isn't it? Now, is it wrong to sing songs that are complicated? No, but everybody can't sing that, can they? I mean, the group can get in there like a song with the, that would use the kind of range, vocal range that Lorinda has. Y'all can't sing that. It was starts low and goes real high. No, I've always thought the Star Spangled Banner should not be the national anthem because it's hard to sing. It should be America Beautiful because that's easy to sing. Oh, beautiful. But Star Spangled Banner, it starts low and it goes really high. It's a very hard song to sing. It's a wonderful song, but it's just hard to sing. I thought we could have picked an easier tune, you know. To that. Great words, but the tune, it's a wonderful song, but it's hard to sing. So, it's one of the reasons I don't like to sing Beulah Land as much. It's a hard song to sing. It's a good song, but I don't mind hearing it, but it's hard to sing. I have to Beulah Land. I have to hold that high note for a long time, and I run out of air because I'm overweight, you know. And so anyway, but it's singable melodies. And then it also says wisdom. As insight and intelligence, great doctrines, we've already talked about this, are learned easily by easily singable songs. And I already talked about that. Let's look at the psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Now, some see this description as separate, distinct categories, while others see them as general descriptions. And so it seems that what Paul is saying should be a wide range of musical expression to teach the congregation on worship of King Jesus. It's not so much that here are these three distinct categories, and this is all that there is. But there is some element to that, we could say. Psalms, many early praise and worship songs, like from the Maranatha movement back in the 70s, a lot of those songs, A Shield About Me comes out of Psalm 3. You remember, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. You remember that one? Or I will call upon the... Straight from the Psalms, okay? Some of those early praise and worship songs. There was a song I used to sing at my last church a lot, a duo by the Shane and Shane. It's called Psalm 34. That was actually the name of the song. I sought the Lord and he rescued me. And the chorus goes, magnify the Lord with me. That straight out of the Psalms. Straight out of the Psalms. So even today we sing Psalms, and some people... That's all they ever did, you know. And again, they were trying to stay biblical, and they missed the point. That's why these songs, such as At the Cross that we sing, and I'm trying to think, what are some other Isaac Watts hymns? We would consider them sort of old-fashioned songs. Isaac Watts was a contemporary Christian musician of his day. Because back then, people were singing just the Psalms, and some people didn't even want any harmony with it. Because they felt like that took away and it maybe showed off a little bit. And my question is, you know, there's some people that just, again, don't have a wide enough range to sing the melody of the song, but they can sing bass or they can sing alto or they can sing tenor. And so we put beautiful harmonies to these songs. And you know, so just keep that in mind, that the church world has had some fight about music for centuries. Mm-hmm. And it's sad that we do that. We don't, you know... Embracing the new doesn't mean you have to kick out the old, you know. But there's the Psalms, and there's hymns. The Apostle Paul employed much music in his writing. He quoted many early church hymns. And there's the new songs in the book of Revelation. If you've seen the book of Revelation, how about singing these new songs? Well, they themselves are studying how vibrant Christian worship is. And hymns will tend to convey a doctrinal or spiritual truth. They're less about experience and more about truth. But then we have spiritual songs. Now, they must not contradict Scripture, but they can be more testimonial. I've mentioned, and this morning, Lorinda's special was classic hymns. Charles occasionally sings Sometimes I Cry from Jason Crabb. That's an experience song. But it's a great testimony song about how I struggle sometimes, and sometimes I cry. Sometimes I'm not all that ought to be for the Lord, but God has mercy upon me, and He helps me. And there's nothing wrong with those kind of songs. I was working out the other day, and occasionally when I do that, I listen to, you know, my classic gospel music. I told you this morning, our family, again, I'm serious. My dog really likes classic gospel music. He loves the Florida Boys. He does. He likes some mellow kind of four-part harmony. He really sort of enjoys that, you know. But I was working out the other day and didn't work out as much as I should have this week. But I was there, and I have a friend of mine. I have some friends, young Christian friends, who they're Christian rappers. And I'm listening to their music, and I'm getting convicted because these guys weren't playing around about the truth. I mean, they were hitting it hard about walking in holiness and honoring God. And they were real clear about it. I could understand their lyrics. And I got under conviction, you know. Now, I'm not the typical Christian rapper. You know, I don't look like that. I'm a guy with a suit. But you embrace that, yeah. You know the kind of music I like the best? I don't listen to a lot of modern praise and worship. It just, I mean, I sort of hate that contemporary Christian music went that route where that's all there is to it. It has its place, but I remember in the 80s and 90s, contemporary Christian music, some groups had good harmonies. All the songs, some songs were strictly church songs, but some of them were songs that just wrote about everyday life and experience of how God ministered to that. We don't realize this, but in the Southern gospel world, I used to wake my kids up with this song. It was the Blue Ridge Quartet singing the song Rise and Shine, which was Johnny Cash's brother Tommy had a hit song with it, you know, and it was a more of a country music song, but it has a spiritual element in it. A lot of the gospel quartets used to cover some of those songs, if they were positive songs, and it gave them an inroad sometimes to take the gospel to people that weren't normally going to listen to gospel music. But there is a place, a spiritual song, you know, many of them can be sung in church, some of them might be better to be sung outside the building, but they do uplift Jesus, but they're okay too. And the key was that we're to do that with thankfulness in our hearts. We sing because we're expressing thanks to the Lord. So that's sort of how we do things in church. But now here's our everyday life. And I just have really, really 2 points here for this. The worship in daily living. Let's look at verse 17 as we close out. And whatever you do, not just singing in church, not just hanging out, but whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Yeah, talking about giving thanks. So the great scholar Adam Clark, who worked with John Wesley many years ago, and the early Methodist theologian, said, let your words be right and your actions upright. So whatever you do. So what all does that involve? It says whatever you do. What do y'all do during the week? You know, you go to work? Okay, do that. Can you serve God at work?
Yes, sir.
You can. That's right, every day. I like that, Charles, every day. What about at school? Can you serve God at school? Can you?
Yeah.
I'm waiting to hear. Can you? That's right. Okay, all right. Look at Bentley, like, can you? Can you do it? That's right. Yeah, you can do it. That's right. You can do it. Okay. What about at home? What about in the community? What about while you're out walking the dog? I have a lot of conversations with people while I'm out walking the dog, because some of you have met my dog. He's a real friendly dog. Everybody loves him. And so I get to talk to a lot of people. They want to hang out and talk to the dog. Sometimes I get to share and testify. And share something about Christ with my neighbors. Not just with my neighbors, but we take the dog to the park and people want to talk to the dog. And we get to sometimes share the gospel. Yeah, so whatever you do in word or deed, and is that just sharing the gospel? Or what's another way that you honor God? Maybe you don't have a chance to witness. What's one way that you would honor God while you're working?
Singing.
You could sing. I'm one of those people that sings all the time, so if you hate listen to singing, you're going to hate me. That's why I'm always humming. And by the way, that's been a testimony. Man, you're always singing. Well, you know, the Lord's just done a lot for me. I like to express that, you know. What about, there's other ways, though. What about...
And work as hard for your employer as you would as if you was working for God.
That's right. Do you remember I told you that when the Soviet Union fell, that in some of those Eastern Bloc countries, like Romania and other places, they were wanting Christian missionaries to come in and teach their workers. You know why? Because 30% of employees were stealing from the company. And they said, but if we can get them saved, even though we don't believe in Jesus, if they'll believe in Jesus and get saved, they'll quit stealing from us. So Christian, I mean, they need to see that you're a Christian by how good a student you are, by how good a worker you are. That's how you honor God.
Right.
Well, here's what Adam Clark said. He said, begin with him and end with him. Invoke his name and pray for his direction and support in all that you do. And thus, every work will be crowned with all requisite success. Doing everything in the name of God and referring everything to his glory is as rational as it is pious. So here's the thing. Worshiping God is not just this esoterical, spiritual thing I do. It's a rational thing. You do rational stuff with your mind. So you worship God. It just makes sense to put God first in everything. I mean, that's basically what, you know, you have to understand in the 1800s and 1700s, like with the Puritans, if you read their books, oh, that's wonderful, but they go all around the world and say something, basically, like I do, okay? So that's why I can't knock them. But yeah, it's rational as it is pious to put God first in everything. So we want to do that. So today, as we conclude, I'm going to ask the... musicians come forward. If there's anybody here who's never surrendered to Jesus and trusted in his saving work on the cross, in his power over sin and evil, in the resurrection, then you can't properly worship God. And you may say, well, everybody in this building's done that, but maybe some people listening by internet haven't. Okay? We want you to know how you can come to know the Lord. You need to first come to Jesus, surrender to him as Lord and Savior, and then you'll be able to truly worship him. But maybe you do know that. You have done this. So I got some questions to ask y'all before I turn things over to musicians. What must change for you to be able to commit yourself to living a life of worship? Do you need to change your routine? Do you need to get up a little earlier? Do you need to have a time daily reading God's word and spending it in prayer? Because I think that's one of the reasons we don't experience God's power to see people converted today. So if we haven't, we need to repent. And then ask somebody to hold you accountable. Let's stand. And that may not be me. It may be a friend. It may be a family member. Hey, your kids, your grandkids, I'll give you, $20 if you'll call me and wake me up every morning at 5 o'clock so I can read you. Whatever you need to do.
Page 85,
Have thine own way. Thank you for your prayer today.
Lord, have thine own way.
Again, at 5 p.m., we'll have some young people coming. We'll go over our music and play our songs. As we're going to have a youth orchestra.